No father. So he's known as Isa ibn Maryam. Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, she is the most pious. She was the most pious of her time. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said Maryam was the most pious of her time. She's the best of women. She is the woman that is going to be the leader of the women in the day of Jannah. She'll be the leader of the females in Jannah. So this is Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. She's lived in seclusion in a closed room in Masjid al-Aqsa. In Masjid al-Aqsa, Masjid al-Aqsa being the masjid in which the Muslims used to pray towards before the Kaaba. So this is, you should know what Masjid al-Aqsa is, where it is. It's in Jerusalem. And she lived in seclusion away from her family, with a parda. And when it was time for Isa alayhi salatu wasalam to come into the dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent Jibreel in the form of a perfect man. And in this room where Maryam was secluded from her family, the man has come into the room. And the first things that the pious Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, she says, I seek refuge from Allah and fear Him if you believe. So she showed her piety here. At the end of the day, she's the most pious. She's saying, I fear Allah. Remember, she's the most pious. Pious meaning the most, one with the most shyness, the one who doesn't do any illicit acts, the one who's engaged in ibadah. This is who Maryam alayhi salam is. And the angel, and this is Jibreel alayhi salam, he says, I have come to you. Don't fear. I am only a messenger of Allah that I may give you a pure son. Who is the pure son?
Isa.
Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Jesus, peace be upon him. Whatever you know him by, this is who the pure son is. And Maryam alayhi salam, remember, her piety comes out again. Well, how can I have a child if no man has touched me? No man has touched me, how can I have a child? So we need mother and dad to be together to have a child. Simple equation. So she's saying, I can't have a child. And the angel, Jibreel alayhi salam, he turns around and he says, so it be. Allah has ordained it. Remember, all Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to do is say, kun. Kun meaning it's an order. It's an order in Arabic. Be. So Allah's hukum, Allah's command is between the Qaf and the Noon. And by the time you get to the Noon, his hukum's happened. So all he says is kun. And all he said to Adam alayhi salam, he created him out of clay, kun, and he come into being. Now think about the universe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he said kun to the universe, and the universe come into being. Oh, wallahi, you want to play games? You want to think you're 10 men? You also want to go out and spend your time wasting time? Wallahi, bro, remember the azab of Allah. Remember the azab of Allah. This story should teach you that Allah's power is manifest. It is massive. You can't handle it. Remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, if I was to reveal these words, meaning the Quran, on a mountain, the mountain, that Tun mountain, that massive layer of mountain, Himalayas, it will be crushed to bits. It will go into dust. It won't be able to handle the power of the weight, the weight of the Quran. And remember, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam has now told Maryam the glad tidings, she's going to have a pure son. And he is also to blow the spirit of Allah into Maryam. He blew into the opening of her cloth. And that is how she became pregnant. And there and then she was pregnant. She fell pregnant. Now when she is pregnant, she has left the masjid. She has left the masjid because she's pregnant. The contraction pains have started. The birth pains have started. And the Quran makes mention of this. If you read Surah Maryam, chapter 19, you'll find the whole story in there. But wallahi, we don't even pick up the Quran. This story that I'm narrating to you, is you. I've learnt it from the Quran and put my own little spice into it. You can pick it up, the Quran, and you can interpret it in your own way. Read a good translation. Ghanzul Iman is one that I recommend, which I use. So Maryam alayhi salam, she has gone out. She has gone to a forest. She has gone to a jungle nearby. She has rested near a dead palm tree. Remember, the palm tree is dead. So she has rested there because the pains of birth, and for those brothers who have children, who've been in the hospital room when baby's about to come out to the dunya, you know what the pains are going through. And she holds onto this trunk, and she gives birth to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And the voice comes from below. The Quran makes mention, now there's two ideas this could be. The voice from below could have been Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, or it could have been Jibreel alayhi salam. Whichever way, it was the voice of Allah, it was the command of Allah. Don't worry, Maryam. Do not worry. Cool your face, cool your eyes with the water. And there and then, a stream gushed in front of her. A stream, miraculously. Whether that was Jesus, alayhi salatu wasalam's foot that hit the ground, but a stream come in front of her. And also, the voice said, the voice below, and most narrations say it was Isa, alayhi salatu wasalam. So she knew there and then that he is talking in the cradle. She was confident that her baby is talking in the cradle. This is a no joke for Maryam, alayhi salatu wasalam. She's still shocked with what people are going to say when she takes the babies back to the Bani Israel. So the Bani Israel were the people of that time, which are the children of Yaqub, the Jews that we call them today, the Yahud. Okay? So that was the Qawm at that time. And Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam is told to cool her eye with the stream of water and also shake the dead palm tree, the trunk of the palm tree, and what will happen? Fresh khajur, fresh dates appear in front of her. Now for those of you who know a bit about nutrition, dates, gym, you know that the date has iron in it, has protein in it. And when you're pregnant as a female, you lack iron because the baby is taking it all off you. For those in the future, you'll learn this when you go to the doctors with your wife. So the woman lacks iron, the khajur has iron in it. So this teaches us for the brothers that are a bit older, we have a wife who is pregnant, during the pregnancy, feed her khajur. And after she's had the baby, feed her khajur as well. MashaAllah. Feed her khajur as well. Now in regards to what happened after that, once she's had the khajur, she's cooled her eyes, she holds baby Jesus, peace be upon him, in her arms. She walks back to the people. Still scared about what people are going to say. You can imagine what people are going to say. They're not going to think that this is the rule of Allah. They're going to think she's committed the fasad. She's committed the haram. She's committed fornication, adultery. She's committed zina. That's what they're going to think. And remember, some Christians believe that due to the fact that Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam gave birth to Jesus without a father, that he is then the son of God. MashaAllah. So they say that he is the son of God. And some of the sects, what do they say? That he is God himself. So they say that he is God himself. This is not the belief in Islam. Jesus, peace be upon him, he come with one saying. He come with one saying that indeed Allah is my Lord and your Lord. Worship him. This is the straight path. This is the ayah of Quran. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us. That's the message that Jesus come. Jesus come with the same message that all the prophets come with. They all come with one message, which is to worship Allah alone. Do not associate partners. The only thing they differed in, from Adam alayhi salam, all the way through to Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the Sharia law, the jurisprudence. The law which you can do, the halal, the haram, what you can do, what you can't do. That's the only thing they differed in. So remember, some sects believe that Jesus, peace be upon him, because he has no father, he is then the son of Allah, or he's Allah himself. But what's more miraculous? What is more miraculous? Adam alayhi salam was born without a father or a mother. So this is Adam alayhi salam. So if you're using the reason that Jesus deserves to be the son of God because he has no father, well then Adam alayhi salatu wasalam deserves more divinity over this right because he has no father or mother. And remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said the likeness of Isa alayhi salam compared to Allah is the same of Adam alayhi salam. That Allah created him from dust, from clay, from mitti, from mud, and molded him, and he said be, and he became into being. And Maryam alayhi salam, she took Isa, peace be upon him, back through to the people of Bani Israel. Who were Bani Israel?
Jews.
So obviously the Jews, remember the Jews of Bani Israel.
Thanks.
And they were Muslims at the time, they had the Torah, they were following Musa alayhi salam. But when Jesus came, their job was to do what? Follow Jesus, peace be upon him. But they rejected him from that young age. Because when Maryam alayhi salam took Jesus back to him, they said, you've committed adultery. You've committed fornication. And the Quran makes mention of this meeting with the Bani Israel for the first time. But the Bani Israel say, yo, oh sister of Harun. Harun being the prophet. Harun could be the prophet, peace be upon him. Musa alayhi salam's brother. Harun and Musa, peace be upon him. Or it could be a pious man in the community at that time. Either one, it was a pious person. So they were saying, oh sister of this pious person, your mother was not an unchaste woman. Your mother didn't do fornication. She didn't do adultery. She didn't commit zina. She didn't go around sleeping with man. That's what they were saying. And neither did your dad. Your dad was a pious man. You've done an evil thing. So remember, they thought that Jesus, peace be upon him, was an illegal baby. That he was born through illegal, whatever, illicit action, and therefore they rejected him on this basis. But when Maryam alayhi salam pointed at the baby, and she pointed at the baby because when the voice came to say, shake the tree and Khajur will fall down, it also said, do not speak to anyone. If anyone says, what's going on, who's this baby, just point at the baby. So she fulfilled that commandment. And when she pointed at the baby, the baby spoke out, Inni of Allah. Indeed, I am the servant of Allah. He has given me the book and he has made me a prophet.
SubhanAllah.
He has blessed me anywhere that I may be.
SubhanAllah.
He also says in the Quran that I am dutiful to my parents. This is Isa alayhi salam giving us a lesson in the Quran that be dutiful to our parents. Isa alayhi salam saying that, look, I'm going to be dutiful to my parents. Not overbearing. So my brothers, be dutiful to your parents. The story is not for me just to pass your time and wait for the scram that's coming in a bit. So you can take little things out. I've told you one little story, one little bit. When your wife's pregnant, give her kajur. That's one thing. The power of Allah is another story, another lesson that I'll give you of the story. Allah. And the third one that I'm giving you now, a lesson of the story, is how Isa alayhi salam says, I've been ordered to be dutiful to my parents, not overbearing.
SubhanAllah.
So this is, as we go along, you should pick out things that, right, I can use that in my own life. All doubts of these people finished. You can imagine now the babies talked. And the leaders, these are supposed to be religious rabbis, religious priests. They follow the Torah, they teach people the religion. When they seen this, they were gobsmacked, first of all. And after that, they thought in worldly terms that if Isa alayhi salam comes with the truth, then we will no longer be in leadership and in power. So from that day on, they planned and plotted to kill him and to get rid of him, to turn people away from him. And remember, Isa alayhi salam is one of three babies that talked in the cradle. In other parts of the Quran, in the commentary of Nur al-Arfan, of Ghanzul Iman, the Quran that I mentioned. And remember the name, Ghanzul Iman. If you've got a phone, put it in there. It doesn't cost much money, but it's worth getting. It gives you a lot of ilm, this Quran. And this is obviously for the older brothers as well. Brother, it costs £20-£30. For you to have that piece of that Quran there, inshallah, you get barakat in your house as well. And it gives you so much knowledge, it's unbelievable. So Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, when he was born, he grew up. The Quran does not teach us how he grew up, but what we know is he grew up. And he was given revelation at the age of 30. Just like the Prophet ﷺ was given revelation at a certain age. Jesus, peace be upon him, was given it at 30. And he was given also the Injil. The Injil being the Bible in Arabic, it's called the Injil, the Gospel. And just remember this, that the Gospel now, there is the New Testament, the Old Testament, this guy's Testament, John's Testament, it goes on and on. They have not come up with one like we have the Quran. Yet again, we were talking about being blessed, a part of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's ummah. We have one Quran. It's not been changed for nearly 1500 years and it's not going to be changed. And you should be blessed that this is your kitab. That all your guidance until the day of judgment is in that book. If only, my brothers, you pick it up and you read the Kalam of Allah and you get the barakah that's in the Kalam of Allah in your lives. If only you picked up the Quran. We talked about reading namaz, Quran is another one, picking up the word of Allah. If I send you a text message now, and I'm sure Adnan and Omer sent you a text message yesterday, if you know them and they've got your number. Did you all read it? Did you all read it? But Allah sent you a text message here. There's your text message. There's your text message. Why are you reading it? So this is the story of Miriam that we're narrating to you. So Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he was sent to the Bani Israel. And he was sent to the people who had deviated from the path of Allah. The path of Allah being Musa alayhi salatu wasalam's kalam. So they've deviated from the path of Allah. And remember, at that time, medical knowledge was prevailing over everything else. Just the same way as in the other prophets, such as Musa alayhi salam, or the Prophet, peace be upon him. When the Prophet, peace be upon him, was alive, poetry was massive. And this is why when you read the Quran, it's written in such a way that even the biggest poets to this day, they cannot handle that Quran. They cannot compete with it on create an ayat. Forget creating a surah that Allah says in the Quran. Create an ayat if you can. And still to this day, nobody has been able to create an ayat. So Musa alayhi salam, when he was alive, magic was prevailing. Jadu was prevailing. Spells, magicians was massive. And Musa alayhi salam come with signs. two major signs. One where he could put his hand in his arm and bring it out and it turns into light.
Subhanallah.
And sit back and it turns into no defect. The light goes away. That's one sign that he was born with.
Subhanallah.
The staff that you've already heard, it turns into a massive snake. And it ate the magician's snake. It might seem like a fairy tale to you, but this happened in reality. And this is part of your belief, that you believe in these stories that I'm telling you. This ain't no blag. This is reality here. So that snake, that magician seen, that massive snake, some narration say, snake from the head there, mouth there. You can imagine how you would feel if you seen a snake that size. How big. If you seen a normal little rat snake, you'll know what it feels like. But imagine seeing a snake that big. And that's when Pharaoh was in front of them people. He also got scared of Musa alayhi salam. The people, the magicians who were fighting Musa alayhi salam, they had to bow down to Allah.
Subhanallah. Subhanallah.
They bowed down. They said, we believe in the Lord of Musa alayhi salam. And Pharaoh said, I will surely crucify you. I will surely crucify you on palm trees. They said, we don't care. You think we're bothered after we've seen them signs? So their iman was so strong after seeing one sign. Wallahi, your Quran is your sign.
Subhanallah.
What is our sign? Look at the words. Look at how it's composed. The seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We were speaking. Beautiful speech about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His life. Uzair finished it off on his life. The things he did. Do we know what he did for the ummah? You call yourself Muslims, and this is me also. We call ourselves Muslims. Are we doing what we should be doing? If the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sat here, would you be happy with the way we're going on? The way we're sat? Is anyone sat in the way that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have sat? For example, alhamdulillah. So yeah, so we should be taking up the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We should be always thinking that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is with us. And if he was here, would he enjoy me to do this act?
That's his eating position.
Would he be happy if I'd done this act? And to find out about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you need to read the seerah.
Subhanallah.
I had a speech a few weeks ago about teaching people about the seerah of the Prophet. There's a seerah, there's a few here. Pick up the seerah, purchase the seerah. Instead of typing in your tunes, 50 Cent, Rick Ross, whoever it may be that you like, instead of typing in niche or this, that and the other in your YouTube player, type in seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Subhanallah.
It's all that you learn about the Prophet's life, inshallah, it will benefit you.
Subhanallah.
I stand here now in front of you after learning about the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. My heart melted and I had to come on the deen. I had to bow down to the fact that Allah is one, and that how great Allah is.
Subhanallah.
And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he did for us. The reason why you're not following the deen is you don't know enough. You do not have enough ilm about it. How do you get the ilm? You watch documentaries. You watch the speeches. You come to the mosque. You ask people. You read the Quran. You read the books. These are ways to get onto it. So we go back to the story of Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam and Isa. Jesus, peace be upon him. Medical knowledge was massive at that time. Medical knowledge was massive at that time. And at that time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave his Nabi, his beloved Prophet, Jesus, peace be upon him, miracles. Miracles such as he could cure the person who had been born blind. Now at that time, the doctors, remember doctoring was massive at that time. They were considered to cure people. So they were big at that time. Three things they said are impossible: to bring the dead back to life, to cure the person who has leprosy, and to cure the person who was born blind. And subhanallah, Isa alayhi salam, he come and cured everyone.
Subhanallah.
He came and manifest signs that showed the power of Allah. First one that he could do, cure leprosy. So he would wipe over someone who had leprosy. Leprosy is a disease where it affects the skin. They have little white lumps on it. And so when Isa, peace be upon him, put his hand over it, what ended up happening, he was pure. The skin was as pure as a brand new skin. So this is the miracle of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Another miracle of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, he cured the person who was blind. So people that were blind, he would put his hand over their eyes, and there and then they can see. So this is another miracle. The third miracle, one of the major, major signs of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. One of the major signs of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam is that he brought the people back to life. He's supposed to have brought four people back to life. He resurrected four people. And these miracles, remember, these show the sign of Allah. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his power is supreme.
Subhanallah.
We need to bow down to the fact that Allah exists. Allah is there. Allah controls everything. Allah provides us. Just the same way Allah provides us with job, with rizq, provides us with a house, with clothes to wear. Wallahi, He can take it all away. And the quicker that you realize this and start coming into the masjid and reading and doing tawbah to Allah for the sins that we've committed and accepting Allah as your Lord and your Razik, Wallahi, you live a great life. And forget this life. This life is going to finish in 60 years. You all realize that, don't you? You know how many people are dying recently? The people in Pakistan that live in my house, one person died yesterday. Person opposite my house died yesterday. Wallahi, people are dying like flies. What we need to do is start realizing this. Are we going to be in the grave when the person next to us says, "Oh, person of the world," meaning you come from the world. Was I not enough sign for you? Was I not a big enough sign for you? Did you not do anything to prepare for this day? What have you prepared? Are you going to wait until that person next to you in the grave is asking you that? What have you prepared? Wallahi, these stories, they teach us that Allah's power is manifest. So the leaders, remember the leaders of the Jews, the Bani Israel, they wanted to kill Isa. And Isa alayhi salatu wasalam was getting more and more popular with time. So what ends up happening, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam asks his disciples, who will be the helpers in the cause of Allah? And the disciples said, we will be the helpers of Allah.
Subhanallah.
And in regards to what happened further on with the crucifixion, at this time the Jewish leaders, they went to the Roman army and they said to the Roman army,
coming.
This person, Isa, he's preaching bad about you. Go and take him out before he takes you.